all you needed. A very warm good morning to our respected principal ma'am, Professor Lata Venkateshan, our respected panelists, Faculty College of Nursing, my dear students and all the delegates. It's a great pleasure for me to welcome you all on the behalf of College of Nursing, AIIMS Delhi, to this panel discussion on the emerging disease that is management of mucormycosis. First and foremost, I would like to express my gratitude to Professor Lata Venkateshan, Principal College of Nursing, AIIMS Delhi, who has taken this initiative to organize this panel discussion. I further welcome our esteemed speakers from various disciplines. Dr. Gagandeep.
Yes, I have joined, yeah.
Dr. Gagandeep, who is an Associate Professor, Department of Microbiology, AIIMS, New Delhi. Sir has area of interest in antifungal stewardship, hospital infection control, therapeutic drug monitoring, histoplasmosis and dermatophytosis. And his major achievement, he has lots of publication to his credit, which includes international and national publication. We welcome you, sir, on this panel discussion platform.
Thank you.
The next speaker is Dr. Upendra Betta, who is the assistant professor from Department of Medicine, AIIMS, New Delhi. Sir, area of interest is critical and emergency care and infectious diseases. Sir has membership of various societies like Indian Society of Trauma and Acute Care, Emergency Medicine Association, Association of Physicians of India and International Society of Infectious Diseases. Sir is working as a principal investigator and co-investigator in number of intramural and extramural research projects. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Dr. Sangeet Agarwal, who is a consultant and assistant professor in head and neck surgery and oncology in Department of ENT, Sir Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi. Sir has done his DNP from Sir Gangaram Hospital. He has fellowship in head and neck oncosurgery from Medanta Cancer Institute. We welcome you, sir. Sorry for the interruption. Our next speaker is Dr. Purva Mathur. Ma'am is a professor and in charge of hospital infection control, Jayaprakash Narayan Apex Trauma Center. Ma'am is in charge of microbiology and infection control services in Trauma Center, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, India. She has been working extensively on epidemiology of hospital acquired infections, and she has developed and implemented the system for surveillance and measures to reduce the burden of hospital acquired infection at Trauma Center. Dr. Mathur holds the academic rank of professors of laboratory medicine. Our next speaker is Dr. Anil Kumar. Sir is working as an additional professor in Head Trauma and Emergency Department, AIIMS, Patna. Sir is working as a deputy medical superintendent and in charge of telemedicine department in Patna. Sir has organized more than 100 health camps in Bihar. He has trained more than 20,000 of people of Bihar, including police officers, school-going children in the field of pre-hospital care. And he is involved in providing health education through various platforms like making videos, role play. His dream is to provide the health facility to the man who is last in the queue. We welcome you, sir. Next speaker is Ms. Sonia Chauhan. She is working as a senior nursing officer and in charge of TC7 ward, Jayaprakash Narayan Apex Trauma Center, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, AIIMS, New Delhi. And she has done her MSc in Counseling and Family Therapy, Fellowship in Emergency Nursing. And she has lots of awards like National Florescent Nightingale Nurses Award, which she got in 2020 by Honorable President of India, Amesonian of America Award as the Best Nurse in 2018, and Amesonian of America Award for the Best Nurse in Research Work. We welcome you, dear Sonia. Now I would like to request Professor Lata Venkatesan, Principal College of Nursing, AIIMS, Delhi, and organizing chairperson of this panel discussion to address the audience. Ma'am, your mic is off. Ma'am, can you hear us? Ma'am, your voice is not coming. Ma'am, your voice is not.
Hello.
Hello, ma'am.
लैपटॉप में आ रहा है
ना, क्या बात आ रही है मैम? वी कांट हियर यू
मैम जी, यहां बात को सुन रहे हैं
हमें नहीं आ रही है वहां, एवरीबॉडी एल्स कैन हियर।
ओके ओके
अदर
स्पीकर ऑन करो, स्पीकर ऑन कर देना।
Ma'am, you can continue. Ma'am, you can continue. Yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am. Please carry on. Now I would like Ms. Mamta to continue the session.
Seema, you can continue.
Thank you so much, ma'am. So here we start with a panel discussion on a very important topic, that is management of mucormycosis. I hereby request Dr. Gagandeep to introduce mucormycosis to us and enlighten why it is also known as blast fungus.
Thank you. So at the outset, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. And again, I would like to clarify, the first thing that I'd like to clarify is that...
yes, please start with the panel discussion.
We are on mute. So at the outset, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. And also, I'd like to clarify first and foremost that calling this disease black fungus, technically, it's a misnomer, because the fungus itself is not black, and it's rather a hyaline, or in other words, it's a colorless fungus. It doesn't produce any pigment. Normally, in mycology, we call fungi which produce the melanin pigment, which is brownish to black in color. That is the group we call them as black fungus. Somehow, because of the reason that it causes, necrosis in the tissue, and the look at the, the damaged or the injured tissue is usually blackish in color. So that is why, that is from where the term black fungus came into existence. So technically it's not a black fungus, but because of the reason that it causes tissue necrosis, which is black in color, so that is why we keep on using the term black fungus. Talking about mucormycosis per se, it is a very invasive and rapidly spreading fungal infection, and the agent organism, this is a group of organisms under the order Mucorales. And they have classical characteristics that the hyphae that they produce are broad. They produce 90 degree angle branching, and the septations in these are very less. And these are one of the few characteristics by which we are able to identify them under a microscope. And that is one of the major tools for identification, the agents of mucormycosis, because once the tissue or the, bowel sample or other samples come to us, we make a simple potassium hydroxide mount, it dissolves the tissue, and then we are able to see those broad aseptate hyphae under the microscope and quickly give the report to the clinician. As far as the growth is concerned, they are also, in comparison to the other fungi, they are fast growing. Normally, fungi take around 7 to 10 days to grow, but mucorales, mostly we see a growth of mucorales within 3 to 4 days, which is again a good aid, because we can, in certain cases, if we are giving the direct microscopy as negative, still within 3 to 4 days, the culture becomes positive. So again, the turnaround time overall in comparison to the other fungal infections is much shorter. Now, talking about, I think that sir, is
thank that you is the so introduction. Much for introducing mucormycosis to us. Sir, what can be the potential route of transmission, how it enters the human body?
So again, there is, needs clarification that humans acquire this infection by inhalation of spores. So the spores of these mucorales are in the environment around us. So it basically requires a susceptible host. Even if you're sitting in this room, if I do sampling of this room, I'm sure we'll find spore of mucorales in this room as well. So basic route is through the inhalation, although rarely there can be other routes like direct inoculation onto the skin causing cutaneous mucormycosis, or even ingestion. If heavy loads of spores are ingested, sometimes rarely in a few categories of patients, it can cause GI mucormycosis as well. But majority, more than 90 to 95% of the patients, they present with rhino-orbital mucormycosis and pulmonary. And both of for these are the root is inhalation.
Thank you, sir. The next question is for Dr. Upendra. Sir, can you please tell us who are the person who are at risk to get this infection?
Yes, good morning, everyone. And I would like to thank Lata ma'am and Seema ma'am and her other team members for organizing such a nice panel discussion. And thank you for the invitation for a tonight's platform for discussion. First of all, if we talk about a risk factor for mucormycosis, most common, I can say ki most common is diabetes mellitus. And second, most common is also related to same, like diabetic ketoacidosis. And nowadays, or even before this pandemic, there is use of steroid, corticosteroid, is one of the also main risk factors for means mucormycosis. And next line is particularly in developed country and Europe and America, you can say malignancy is also most common there. And whatever I told right now, like diabetes, diabetic ketoacidosis, steroid is most common in India or other developing country. In developed country, obviously there are so much of malignancy and some organ transplantation is going on. So there I can say malignancy. Second is say some organ transplantation, different organ transplantation like lung, kidney, heart. There are so many others like hematological means malignancy or hematopoietic stem cell transplant. They are also at high risk for development of or transmission of mucormycosis. Next in QE for means mucormycosis at risk is like even nowadays you can say COVID-19. Nowadays it very means highlighted yes, why means they are high risk of development of mucormycosis. So we'll discuss later on. Next is other immunosuppressant group, any patient who is getting immunosuppressive therapy like chemotherapy or steroid or post-renal transplant patient getting so many immunosuppressive drugs like tacrolimus, cyclosine, there are so many things. Next in queue is HIV or any other autoimmune disorder is at risk for development of mucormycosis. Next to all this is very important is any means burn patient, plastic, any patient is having means any surgery or patient who is got means trauma recently or means got dressing with the contaminated means dressing materials. These are all at risk for development of mucormycosis. And after all this, you can say, just I told the COVID is a very important risk factor. These are the all means most common, we can say these are the risk factor for development of mucormycosis.
Sir, can a patient who was having the mild disease, mild COVID-19 disease, and the person was on home isolation, the person was not on any oxygen therapy, can we also...
Basically what we got here at AIIMS particularly, I can say ki majority of patients who come to us and who are coming to us are mild or asymptomatic. Majority of person, more than 50% or 60% I can say ki are from means only asymptomatic or from mild category patients. Only very few of you can say 30-40% are means having history of severe or moderate COVID disease. Yes.
Thank you so much, sir. Nowadays we are getting various updates how this can be transmitted. Some are saying many updates are claiming that the virus can transmit through use of unsterile oxygen, tap water in humidifier, and repeated use of the same mask as a cause of this infection. So I request Dr. Purva Mathur to enlighten to what extent this is true. Dr. Purva Mathur, please. Can I request Dr. Sangeet to answer this question? Dr. Sangeet Agarwal is one of the experts with us. Yes, sir.
Can you hear us?
Sir, can you hear us?
Can you repeat your question?
Sir, nowadays we are getting... yes, sir. Are we audible to you?
Yes, sir.
Are we audible to you?
Can you repeat the question?
Yes. Dr. Sangeet, are you able to hear us? Okay, sir. Nowadays, we are getting various updates on social medias and other related platforms that use of this unsterile oxygen tubing, tap water in humidifier, and repeated use of the same mask are some of the causes of this mucormycosis infection. So please enlighten us to what extent this is true.
There must be some study. There is no study available till now that there is a mucormycosis incidence, high incidence in cases of menstrual oxygen. So we are treating more than 100 patients in our hospital. I think it is the largest center in our Gangaram hospital, which we are treating the mucormycosis patients. And yes, it is true that most of the patients were admitted somewhere else, and now after getting oxygen, but there are different factors in those cases. So we can't say that oxygen is available for this trial or this trial. So we don't know about this. There is no study, so we can't say this is just this. In previous times, we also saw many mucormycosis patients who were on the oxygen also. So,
Thank you so much, Dr. Sangeet. Please explain how this infection progresses in human body. What are the stages of how this infection progresses in human body?
There is no voice.
Am I audible now, sir?
Yeah.
Sir, please explain to us how this infection progresses. What are the various stages of this particular infection?
In almost 100% cases, it starts from the cavity. So whenever it is confined into the nasal cavity, it is, we can say there is no concrete stage yet. When it is limited to the nasal cavity, in the nasal cavity, it starts mainly from the a part of the nasal cavity which is known as the middle turbinate. And when the middle turbinate gets necrosed by the mucormycosis, then it can be said that it is a stage 1. When it spreads into the sinonasal sinuses, is the nasal sinuses, paranasal sinuses, it can be say stage 2, or when it invades the orbit or involves the eye, it can say stage 3, or when it goes into the brain, it is stage 4. So whenever it goes into the brain, when it reaches to upper side, or it can reach into lower side also, and it can involve the lungs also. So whenever it involves the lungs or in upper side, it can involve the brain. So whenever it goes into the lungs, it is a very serious issue. Or goes into the brain, it is also a very serious issue, when it is almost 100% fatal when it goes into the brain.
Thank you so much, sir, for elaborating these stages to us. What all clinical manifestation patient get at various level of these stages? What are the clinical manifestations that patient present during these various stages?
Various stages.
Yes,
sir. So whenever it is confined to the nose, the patient patient can complain of nasal stuffiness, nasal blockage, nasal discharge, which may be prolonged, lengthish, or like this statement. In this statement, patient may complain of nasal discharge, nasal blockage, and then should be a history of culprit all the time. Severe acidosis, ferritin levels should be high in some cases, severe COVID attack. And in stage 2, whenever it involves the sinuses, there may be a swelling on the cheek, there may be a loss of sensation on the cheek, there may be a edema, swelling on the cheek, or there may be a pain on the cheek. Whenever it goes into the orbit or into the eye, there may be vision loss, vision, double vision, whenever it involves the muscles. Patient may complain that he can see or see two things at a time. And whenever it goes into the brain, patient may get brain symptoms like loss of consciousness and stroke, etc.
Thank you so much, sir. Now, Purva ma'am is there with us.
Yes.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sandeep. Our next question is to Dr. Gagandeep. So, very frequently we are listening to two terms, black fungus and white fungus, in news and everywhere. So, what is the basic difference between these two fungus?
Black fungus, technically, there are the group of fungi which produce melanin. So, as I told in the introduction as well, that calling mucormycosis black fungus is a misnomer. It should not be so, but because of the disease presentation, we are calling it as a black fungus. There are other reports of people calling, you know, isolation of white fungus, yellow fungus. So, these have been, which organism was causing it has not really been well explained. Although there are a few reports where the white fungus that was reported ultimately turned out to be probably Candida species from one of the patients. Yellow fungus is, it wasn't a human pathogen, so I'm not very sure of how it was reported.
Not audible, Dr. Seema. There is no audio. Audio.
Yes,
ma'am. Are
we audible now?
Yes, I think better you log in from your Google Meet and you can talk. I feel a lot of disturbance between.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, Dr. Gagandeep. So, please, can you again repeat what is the basic difference between black fungus and white fungus?
Yeah. So, as I told in my introductory remarks as well, that black fungus ultimately, you know, technically speaking, black fungi are those which produce melanin. And so even mucormycosis, the agents of mucormycosis are not black fungi per se, but because of the disease presentation, the disease, you know, necrosis that we see in the tissue, it is termed as black fungi. So these are two different entities actually. If you talk about other reports of white fungus and yellow fungus, which people have been reporting, probably the white fungus was Candida species, which somebody had reported. Yellow again was a non-human pathogen, which again was reported from somewhere else. So rather, I would like to take this opportunity at this forum to request whoever is reporting any fungus, they should get it properly identified from a specialized mycology laboratory before going into the media and creating scare amongst the general population. So that's very important. So as of now, we're dealing with only mucormycosis. That is the main fear. People don't need to worry about white fungus and yellow fungus because there was just single report and that too wasn't confirmed.
Thank you so much, Dr. Gagandeep. Mucormycosis was present even before this pandemic. So why it has become a major concern now? Dr. Upinder, please elaborate.
Yeah, nowadays you are getting so many of mucormycosis patient and this we can say ki may be related to COVID-19. The reason may be one is due to pandemic for last 1 year, more than one year, patients particularly who is diabetic is not getting proper treatment. and maybe means uncontrolled diabetes remains for last 1.5 years.
Mm-hmm.
Second, you can say that due to large number of population actually affected in this pandemic and due to unavailability of the bed or hospitals facilities or due to so many other reasons, they all got actually treatment at home.
Mm-hmm.
And without any means, particular means direction with doctors or physicians, they all themselves took so much of steroid.
Yes.
This may be the second reason. And third, may be due to some COVID related things, like due to COVID, there are so many patients who are taking so much of steam, so much of steroid nebulization. And so much of means that due to this steam inhalation and this steroid means there is some breach in nasal mucosa. You know, spores are available everywhere. This is not a new thing. Just suppose ki some breach in your skin or mucosa and there is a spore in surrounding you, and then chances of means transmission of that spore into body is very high. That may be the reason of one of the main thing. There are so many reasons I told. One is diabetic, poorly controlled diabetes. Second is steroid, inadequate use of steroid. And third, maybe due to means this high steam inhalation, or maybe due to means you can say keep majority of patient actually remain at home,
mm-hmm.
and closed home. Even patient who has been admitted nowadays or previously also, they are also in very closed means. Things means house or hospitals or like that. There is no ventilation patients are getting even at home or even at hospital. Very difficult to get means proper ventilation,
mm-hmm.
and that may be the one reason for high transmission of this means mucormycosis. So this we can say, but there are so many things we will get later on in future. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Dr. Upendra.
May I request Dr. Purva Mathur? Ma'am, can you hear us? Dr. Purva? Ma'am,
no.
Can you hear us?
Dr. Purva Mathur, are we audible to you?
Yes.
Ma'am, can you hear us? Yes, ma'am.
Seema, it is better to log you on Google Meet and you handle the panel discussion. I think tech facility, lot of echo and lot of disturbance in between, and the time is getting lapsed.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. So my next question
is... We are not able to hear anything at all. Lot of echo also.
Is it clear, ma'am?
A lot of echo.
There is a lot of echo and they are not able to hear. So Seema and Mamata, please log in from your Google Meet and continue the panel discussion.
Am I audible now, ma'am?
ये दो डिफरेंट लॉबीज हैं, डिफरेंट
एप्स
उससे चलाइए, एक ही से चलाइए, दो से एक होती
है। Okay, ma'am, the next question is, what is the pre-treatment?
We are so sorry for this technical. technical error. Just give us few seconds to rectify.
Seema, please ask them to stop streaming in YouTube at least. I think that is why the echo is there.
For any fungal infection, and there is no pre-treatment also advocated, so it's not advisable to take preventive antifungals either locally or systemically to prevent mucormycosis. Most of the cases, like we have seen the large multicentric study by PGI group, in which it was found that it's mostly those factors like steroids and diabetes and COVID per se. Severe disease, so it's basically the most factors which are causing mucormycosis. We can't really prevent this because those are everywhere. So, the take home message is that one should not take home preventive antifungals, and there's no vaccine available or to be made in the near future or future for mucormycosis.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am, for enlightening us. I think Dr. Anil is with us. We welcome you here, sir. Can you please tell us what are the various management protocols are available in hospital to treat patients with mucormycosis? Am I audible, Dr. Anil? Am I audible to you, Dr. Anil?
Audible, dear. Please continue. I think he is
left. That's what I feel. He is still there. He is visible, but I'm not sure if he is able to hear me. Yes, sir. Yes. Huh. Good morning, sir.
Yeah,
yes, sir. Yeah. Yes, sir. You are audible. Sir, we welcome you here.
Very slow. Can you
switch
loudly, please?
Yes, sir. Good morning. We welcome you here. Sir, please, can you...
Good morning.
Sir, can you share some of the treatment protocols available to treat these patients with mucormycosis?
Yeah, definitely. For the treatment protocol, first of all, we should confirm the diagnosis of mucormycosis, number one. And number two, we should get RT-PCR, especially to get precision in which ward, whether in the COVID positive ward or COVID negative ward, in which patient required admission. Then we will have to follow the principle of management. So, for the confirmation of diagnosis, we require to consider the clinical presentation of the patient. And also, we need to consider the predisposing factor. Definitely, I think some who is bigger, about the clinical presentation and predisposing factor like history of diabetes mellitus and treatment history of the corticosteroid for a longer time, and other immunosuppressant history and history of the COVID infection. So, if all these findings associated with some patient with clinical presentation, then next step is RT-PCR. Third is the principle of the management, which is always surgical. Because anywhere, suppose if mucormycosis is present in the skin or lungs or GI tract, everywhere the treatment protocol should be to excise it, cut it, till it starts to bleed. But in present scenario, in this pandemic, the commonest presentation of this mucormycosis is ROCM, that is called rhino-orbital cerebral mucormycosis. And for this, we can go for the open approach. Endoscopic
approach. So I would like to show you some photographs. How recently is my
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is which I'm writing yesterday. A 65-year-old lady connected to us after 6 weeks of COVID. And he had history of corticosteroid use for a longer time. Also, she has a known case of diabetes with uncontrolled blood sugar. So she presented with us and we operated yesterday. So what I showed that I would like to calculate which type of incision we are using for the open case. So at the medial canthus, you can see here. And after exposing this incision, see how bad is this fungus. Totally destruction, totally necrosed maxilla, ethroid, spheroid, and these all are the black and the necrosed tissue which we use to remove. So my purpose to show this diagram and photograph, see the other patient, all of the alveolar process along with the tooth was totally used. So we removed all this part. So purpose here is to whenever and wherever. If you are looking and you are seeing the evidence of finger, our target should be to excise it, cut it, remove it. That's all. And in ROCM, after removing, as there is the space, residual space, so we need to pack it and we require to consequent dressing or alternate it. Keep your patient regularly in ICU. Along your patient, she should also plan for reconstruction further after the recovery operation.
Thank you, sir. So, I would like to ask the next question to Purva ma'am. Ma'am, do we have some infection control policy for the patient with mucormycosis in AIMS? Can you please enlighten that? Dr. Purva, are we audible now clearly? Ma'am, please elaborate, are there some infection control policies in our hospital to deal with this mucormycosis?
So, mucormycosis is from the most driven infection, you know. So, the role of this is more of control of host factors. So, like we have almost 2 wards, this infection is not transmitted patient to another. So there's very little chance that the patient for my horses in the form of patients are at risk. So the infection control procedures are not per se aimed at control of the my horses outbreaks, because there are no reported outbreaks of member in the war. The only precaution or prevent that needs to be taken is the ventilation, because it's too much. The ventilation should be proper so that patients who are not exposed to smoke. The AHMT should be optimal. So it's basically the ventilation, because it's in a dusty environment that generally the spores thrive. So in all none of them have been hospital per se. So they are not evidence-based media hypes that the industry doctors have any indication. All the mucormycosis, and that's why undue panic needs to be avoided, that you know there must be some isolation oxygen has to be water. The general infection control guidelines for transmission-based precautions and hygiene, general care and cleanliness are sufficient, because very few, the largest study on mucormycosis from September to December 2020, by Dr. Amarok Chakravarti's group, that only 0.2% of COVID patients who were hospitalized, they got fever. So it's, they are not getting it from the hospital. That's why no special infection control measures have been designed or fever. You just have to follow the normal guidelines, which are there for bacteria, which are there for other things, and they will take them.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for enlightening us. So, thank you so much, ma'am, for enlightening us. So, my next question, I would like to ask the next question to Dr. Upin. Dr. Upin, can you tell us what can be the medical management for to treat this infection?
Yeah, actually, if you talk about a treatment, there are three types of treatment. One is treatment or prevention of risk factor. Second is surgical, as we discussed just now. And third is medical. Medical is also very important treatment. Actually, nowadays, as early as possible, once patient is diagnosed, yes, this patient is having mucormycosis, you have to do surgical debridement, or you have to start as early as possible medical treatment. Nowadays, we have, there are three types of pharmacological therapy available, established, means FDA approved. One is, you know, amphotericin B, and second is posaconazole, and third is isavuconazole. These are the three drugs FDA approved, available, established role of antifungal in mucormycosis available. Whatever we are doing here or giving to the patient, one is amphotericin. In early stage, for few weeks, 4 to 6 weeks, or on the basis of means different criteria. In early stage, actually, after just after diagnosis, or on the basis of clinical suspicion, even there is no definitive diagnosis, you have clinical suspicion, high clinical suspicion, in that condition also, you have to start pharmacological treatment. If you have amphotericin B, then you have to start. There are so many types of amphotericin B. One is, as you know, traditional like deoxyplate. Second is liposomal, and third is lipid complex. So nowadays, liposomal amphotericin is available everywhere, I think. But due to pandemic, you can say that nowadays very difficult to get everywhere. But it is available, particularly at our center. The amphotericin we give, particularly there are two types of brand available. One is fungizome and second is ambizome. Actually, ambizome hai and fungizome are some little bit differences. Ambizome actually comes in actually unilamellar vesicles, and this comes in powder form. And second, fungizome comes in solution, and that is in multilamellar vesicles. And that multilamellar vesicles you have to break into unilamellar. That's the reason you have to sonicate this fungizome in sonicate. And then after 35 minutes of sonication, you have to, sonication is basically to change multilamellar into unilamellar, so that the bioavailability of that drug will be at maximum level. And then after 45 minutes of sonication at 25 to 30 degree of centigrade, then you only give this medicine. But bioavailability has some little bit, means compared to ambizome, it is little bit less. Then dose. Dose is actually, we give whatever we give here, 3 to 5 milligram of fungizome. 3 to 5 milligram per kg per day for few weeks. And we have to see, means some side effects. With some side effects, most common side effect we talk is nephrotoxicity. Majority of patients actually develop. This is bookies key, there is less me chances of nephrotoxicity with amphotericin B, but we see here almost all patients develop nephrotoxicity with even fungizome. Most in form of nephrotoxicity, and second most common is electrolyte imbalance. Like most common in electrolyte imbalance is hypokalemia. So these are the most common. There are so many other means, neurological, gastrointestinal, and some other metabolic side effects are also there. But there are two main concerns as a clinician. One is nephrotoxicity, and second is this electrolyte imbalance. Second, after means all these treatments for after a few weeks, if we see yes, patient has improved or improving, and patient we are planned to discharge that patient, then we switch to salvage therapy, means some oral form of therapy. So we have two options. One is posaconazole and second is isabutaconazole. So posaconazole is also very expensive. When we switch to amputation B to posaconazole, the dose of posaconazole is actually we give 300 milligram for BD for first day and we start with 300 milligram OD. And then when next question is for how long we should give. So again, there are some clinical means judgment ki whether patient is improving or not. Second is whether your risk factor is resolved or not, if patient is diabetic control or not. And third is very important radiological imaging. Whether means on the this imaging finding patient has improved or not. And third and fourth, you can say very important, you have to again do some histopathological testing. Whether means all means fungal things has been gone or not. If yes, it has gone, then you can consider for stopping all antifungal drugs. Even some patients actually requires lifelong antifungal agents. These are the actually main treatment of Lyme, and we can follow, you can see all these clinical risk factors, imaging findings, and again histopathological examination and culture. Culture is also very important. If culture is negative, histopathologically negative, radiologically improved, or there is no evidence, and clinically patient is better, then we can stop.
While at the time of administration of this drug, can you tell us some more precautions which a healthcare worker or nursing officer should follow
yes.
while administering this drug?
This is very important because these drugs, importation B, you can say nephrotoxic, and majority of patients develop nephrotoxicity. So there are two things we can do. One is very important. You have to hydrate the patient with 500 ml or 1000 ml with normal saline before giving this amputation. And second is administration infusion rate is very important. Infusion rate is very important. Ideally, if you are giving amputation B, liposomal amputation B, then you have to administration over, infuse over 2 hours. And later on, you can decrease to 1 hour, but ideally 1 to 2 hours is required. If you are giving just amputation B deoxyglate, traditional one, old one, then you have to infuse over at least 6 hours. 2 to 6 hours. If you will infuse over very less hours, less than means recommended, then there will be high chances of renal toxicity. And there will be high chances of some anaphylactic reaction. And there will be high chances of other side effects.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir. As you were talking about this radiological imaging,
yeah.
What are diagnostic tests we can do if you are suspecting any patient is having mucormycosis?
Yeah, diagnostic test is, first of all, patient should have some risk factor, very important. Yes, patient is having risk factor for mucormycosis development. Second, you have to see whether this patient is having features suggestive of either sign or symptoms of mucormycosis or not. And third, very important is microbiological, like EOH, fungal culture, PCR, and finally, definitive diagnostic is histopathological. And fourth and most important, very important, is imaging. These are the line of diagnostic means things that you can get means from all that all I think available at means in good hospital.
Thank you so much, sir. As we know, there are now number of cases of mucormycosis that are being admitted in hospitals are increasing day by day, and thus the role of nurses is also increasing for caring those patients. So my next question is for Ms. Sonia. Ms. Sonia, are you able to hear us?
Yeah, I'm able to hear you.
Okay, Sonia, we welcome you here. Please tell us the specific nursing management that we are doing in our setting for caring for patients admitted with mucormycosis.
Okay. So, first of all, I would like to thank Dr. Lata for giving me this opportunity. Dr. Seema Sasteva. Very easy. So I would like to share the same. just a minute. So am I, is my PPT audible, visible?
No, Sonia, still now it is not visible.
Yes, now
it's okay, visible. Okay, it's not visible.
Okay, okay. So, basically, as we all know that this mucormycosis is not a new disease, it is, Dr. Nadeem has also mentioned that it, mucus are present everywhere. The only thing is, the person who has got low immunity has got a tendency to catch it and then have a mucormycosis infection. So, the role of nurse management, the nurse's role is very much important because we are the ones who are directly getting the patient, and that's our role is very important. First of all, we all should understand why is this happening and what can be done to optimize the outcome and to minimize the morbidity if the person has got infection, then how the spread of infection can be stopped. At initial level, and what how can we improve the survival of the patient? So, the rule of thumb is it is always prevention is always better than care. So, if the patient, if we are caring for COVID-19 patient, because this mucormycosis is not new, but previously it is very certain increase in mucormycosis. After this COVID-19 infection, because of immunocompromise of the patient due to use of immunity status. So, also, very important thing is judicious and supervised use of systemic corticosteroids, which are being used during treatment of COVID-19 and retrocedure. Such drug has to be used with proper supervision and guidance. There should be aggressive monitoring. Because of having diabetes with the patient who are previously diabetes or suddenly there is increase in blood sugar level after COVID-19. So blood sugar monitoring is very much important when we are caring for COVID-19 patients. Strict aseptic techniques should be followed by administering oxygen, because nowadays we have also seen that the route of it goes through inhalation route with the mycosis spread. So the oxygen which we are administering, we must ensure that humidifier which we are using, it has to be cleared properly, the tubing has to be changed periodically, the humidifier has to be cleared as well as it has to be dipped in solution for disinfection. Personal and environmental hygiene of the patient has to be maintained, because the environment contains some force, and COVID-19 patients are already low immunity. They may have we will have to ensure that the patients are wearing masks so that there are less chances of inhalation of and getting infected. And if there are high risk patients, now what are high risk patients? Who are on mechanical ventilation for more than 3 weeks, who are getting oxygen therapy for more than 3 weeks, who are diabetes and having COVID-19. So these kind of patients should be identified, and prophylactic fungal use can be done with the advice of medical physicians. After that, health education, the role of health education is important. We must teach the patient what they are supposed to do and what they are not supposed to do, do's and don'ts. So then they should give proper instant of diabetes to the patient, proper sugar level has to be checked. We will have to watch for early signs of mucormycosis. As nurse, we must identify ourselves that if they start from the nose, so there is belching, if there is any discharge from the nose, so it has to be identified. The patient should also be able to recognize, and he should be able to communicate to the medical person. Basic hygiene and cleanliness has to be emphasized, and medical advice has to be followed by the patient, and proper complete treatment has to be taken. Very important is don't. So patient should not self-medicate, especially steroids, because in the last month when there was peak of this COVID-19, we have been that there were so many people who were should not be done. And they should not delay the in reporting the symptom to the physician. Over the counter drug, typographical error. And the important thing is early identification of any symptoms and seek medical advice has to be told to our patients. Now, when we are caring for patients as a nurse, even as a nurse or as a healthcare provider, our safety is top priority. So, use of PPE according to the institutional protocol has to be done. If it is a COVID care clinic, we must use level 3 PPE and or level 1 PPE. It depends on where you are working. Whenever we are working in emergency, as an emergency nurse, we should have high index of suspicion that our patients who are coming if they're reporting that I'm having discharge from the room, I'm having nasal congestion. So you should have high index of suspicion. Yes, this patient has recently been diagnosed with COVID-19 now, maybe less than 2 weeks. And after that, the patient is having this problem. So he might be in case of a black color. So we should immediately suspect him, and we should consider him for testing for mucormycosis. And we must always, it is not only for mucormycosis, for all the emergencies, APCD principle has to be followed. Then Priyas and Dr. Anil has already mentioned, they should prepare the patient whether there is COVID criteria, if the patient COVID status is positive or negative, RT-PCR negative. And we all must understand that COVID, this mucormycosis is not being treated by a single person. It is a multidisciplinary approach we should follow. So it will involve the right from the diagnosis. In this panel discussion also, we have good team of microbiologists. Then we have got doctors from radiology who will be required for CT and MR. The surgeon, it will be ENT surgeon, ophthalmologist, physician. So and if the technical involvement, we may require neurosurgeon. So it is a multidisciplinary team. So the nurse has to assess for possible probable and proven signs of ROCM, because ROCM is the mainly disease which is coming along with this COVID-19. So possible are those patients who have undergone COVID-19 and they are having they might have taken corticosteroid. And if the patient has any clinical signs and symptoms, they have what are reported in the emergency, we can consider them as probable patients. And if it is proven by the diagnostic procedure, for example, by nasal biopsy, TRS, PNR, or CT or MR, then we can say that they are the proven cases. And the treatment for this is medical and surgical. So medical for surgical, till the patient is ready for the surgical management, the medical management has to be initiated as soon as possible. For that patient has to be admitted in the definitive care unit. So again, in the definitive care unit, whether it is ward or preferably if the patient can be admitted in the ICU, depending on the status of the patient, we will have to maintain the patient care, because when the patient is having mucormycosis, they will be having nasal bursting or discharge from the nose. So that will make the airway tractate difficult for breathing. So has to be maintained. For that, nasal cleaning has to be done with the normal saline, and breathing. For breathing, we will have to monitor the saturation of the patient. We will have to prevent hypoxia in the patient. We will have to administer oxygen to mask or if the patient requires mechanical ventilation. So that has to be assessed and managed accordingly. Right now, Dr. Upinder has mentioned that patient has to be hydrated. So that we will have to establish IV lines, and hydration of the patient is very important, because the patient will get antifungal medicines which are associated with renal side effects. So hydration of the patient is very important. And if the patient has got cerebral involvement, then we will have to assess for the signs of disability. For example, patient has been having convulsion, what is the level of consciousness of the patient, and if the patient is having seizure, how can we protect the patient? So these things have to be taken care of. along with that, random in this program, patient from rhino to sinus, then to occipital, then patient may have facial edema. For that, we will have to ensure that patient is taking adequate intake, and for that intake and output of the patient properly, we will have to look for a slightly different patient. For example, loss of sensation or any numbness on the face. When the patient will be having facial edema, then they won't be able to eat the normal food what we are eating. So we will have to ensure that patient is getting adequate nutrition with the help of soap or liquid diet. If there is involvement of eye, unfortunately, then we will have to ensure that patient's eyes are being kept clean. So cleaning of eye has to be done from from inner to outer side, as we are following the we will have to follow the basic principles. Keeping those principles in mind, we will have to make ensure the cleaning of eye drops has to be administered as per the advice of the doctors, and we will have to periodically assess the visual acuity of the patient because it is prone to get affected. And if the patient has got cerebral involvement, we will have to assess the consciousness level, the seizure, or if the patient has got convulsions, we will have to do the convulsion management. And you know, I have mentioned in a very bold letter, we nurses are responsible to take care of patient safety. So safety in terms of patient should not have any injury for that, because the patient will not be able to see. So side rails has to be put on the bed. If the patient is going to ambulatory, then we will have to ensure that somebody is accompanying the patient to the toilet. And if the patient is on the bed, then we will have to ensure that he should not fall. We will have to ensure that patient self-care activities are being taken care of properly. Now, already it has been very, nicely explained by Upinder sir that antifungal treatment has to be instituted for the patients who are having mucormycosis. So there are the drug of choices like liposomal amphotericin B. This particular picture is of Sonicator. I purposefully kept it so that everybody can see it. We can liposomal amphotericin B. It comes in a big vial, so we can keep the vials here. It has to be sonicated. So we can accommodate in some sonicator three vials in some. So it depends on the size of the sonicator. So sonication has to be done. After sonication, the vial has to be kept for some time on room temperature, say 30 to 45 minutes. After that, it has to be diluted in 5% dextrose, and infusion should be given with a slow rate. So we will have to set the drop in such a way that we are administered in maximum of 6 hours. We will have to assess for side effects. If any, then we will have to keep the emergency equipment ready. We will have to keep all the drugs, for example, amyl hydrocortisone, so anti-anaphylactic agent. And as we are using 5% dextrose, if the patient is diabetic, then we'll have to neutralize it before administration. If the patient is not diabetic, then strict glucose monitoring of the patient has to be done. Renal function has to be checked because these drugs are associated with nephrotoxicity. If this conventional amphotericin B is another choice, but it is less expensive. I mean, it is cheaper option, but it is associated with so many side effects. So it can be used only if renal functions are normal. In this, no sonication is required. But before giving this medicine, because there can be chances of side effects. Injection hydrocortisone, injection avil, injection BCU has to be given as pre medication. It has to be diluted and infused. Glycemic control, as we were doing in liposomal amphotericin B, has to be done. And we will have to monitor for side effects continuously. It is not like we have started the medicine and we can leave the patient. No, we will have to continuously observe our patient for headache, dyspnea, tachycardia, weakness or drowsiness. And apart from these, other antifungal agents are oral posaconazole or oral isavuconazole. So these can be used. Now this is the fresh heart. This is very old picture. So question asked on this call, this nursing officer. So we will have to keep our crash card ready. It has to be checked in every shift, and after every shift, after every use, it has to be refilled. So this is our responsibility to maintain and prepare and maintain our crash card, so that if any emergency happens, we may be able to handle it properly. Dr. Anil has very well mentioned that ultimately surgical management has to be done for all the patients with mucormycosis. For that, nursing, very important role of nursing is in preoperative phase as well as in postoperative phase. So in preoperative phase, vital monitoring of the patient has to be done. We will have to prepare the patient for surgery, and we will have to do the glycemic control, and we will have to do all the preoperative preparation as prescribed by the surgical management team. After operation, the vital monitoring of the patient is very important. Patients vitals has to maintain so that patient can have stable hemodynamics. Prevention of infection in terms of wound management, in terms of antibiotic use has to be done. So take home message for all the nurses over here is, it is always prevention is better than cure. So you should have high index of suspicion that these patients are having, each patient can have mucormycosis, and early detection has to be done with the help of proper diagnostic tools. Timely medical and surgical intervention to be done. Medical intervention with the help of antifungal agents, surgical intervention to be done. And after that, secondary damage to the patient has to, we should, this is like in trauma also, we follow that we should not do further harm. In other things also, we should not do further harm to the patient. And along with that, we should stop the infection in the beginning stage only, so that there may not be any secondary damage. And as a nurse, top priority is to prevent the to ensure the safety of the patient. And at the end, I would like to say we must know what we can do with all what we have and where we are. Mm-hmm. So and we are very important member of medical team. So together along with the other community members, we will win the fight against this pandemic, against this mucormycosis. So I hope I have done this nursing arrangement. I'm now stop sharing the thing. So if any audience will be any question, I would happily address it.
Thank you, Sonia, for clarifying the nursing concept and motivating our audience. So we will take a few questions from our audience. So the audience, one of the delegates have asked a question. Why more number of cases of mucormycosis have been reported in India, and that too in second wave, as compared to the other countries? So may I request Dr. Gagandeep to answer this question?
So actually there are multiple reasons for, having many more cases, although it's a known fact that India regularly reports a large number of cases of mucormycosis every year. Even in the non-COVID pandemic, we were reporting a large number of cases of mucormycosis, because one of the basic reasons for that is that we have a large population of individuals who are pre-diabetic or diabetic, and in many patients, these are, they have uncontrolled diabetes, and there are so many patients who ultimately they don't know that they are diabetic. Once they land with mucormycosis, it is then that in the emergency, we do their sugar levels, and we come to see that they have uncontrolled diabetes. So routinely also India reports a large number, like our lab, we report somewhere around 100 cases every year, routinely also. But specifically in this pandemic, probably in comparison to the first wave also, if we see the denominator in this wave, number one, is very huge. So definitely if your denominator is huge, the numerator also parallelly, increases. Number two is probably this time the hypothesis, one of the important hypotheses is that, as Dr. Pindra had also mentioned, that the Delta variant is directly, damaging the islet cells of the pancreas. And because of that, there are many patients who were pre-diabetic or who did not have diabetes, and they've landed up with uncontrolled diabetes. So that is the other reason. And then misuse of steroids. I think that these three together have really culminated in a large population of uncontrolled diabetes, and they have been an important cause of increase in cases of mucormycosis. And we've seen that almost 90% of our patients are diabetic. So only steroid use is not very important. You know, it's probably something else going on in the background, that ultimately a large number of patients are diabetic or uncontrolled diabetes who have had mucormycosis.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, one of the delegates we have asked, majority of the cases are being reported from Maharashtra and Gujarat. Is there some specific reason behind it in terms of epidemiology, why it is coming here?
I'm not very sure, but again, there are hypotheses that probably due to a larger, environmental factors, probably that they have a higher load of spores in their environment, the humidity and temperature is a little different from North India. So those are the reasons which I can think of that probably, they are having relative to us, they are having more number of cases. So, and another reason also is that the group of, I know a couple of people, they are working in ID and microbiology, so they are also well aware of the disease. So knowing the disease, picking up the disease early on is also has contributed in certain areas reporting more cases. So probably that is also.
Thank you so much, sir. Another question which one of the delegates has asked is taking steam inhalation is also contributing to happening this black fungus. So, Dr.
Upinder,
can you answer this question?
Yes, maybe before, just see, particularly in the month of April or May, there were so many patients at home with COVID and taking steam inhalation. There are certain methods with steam inhalation should be taken. Particularly a patient who is not knowing how many times it should be taken and at what temperature and with which machine. Then there will be chances. Just suppose ki some patient is taking at higher temperature, directly in the mouth. There will be chances of mucosal break. And you know ki spores are everywhere. And regularly there is some trauma is going on in mucosa. Then transmission of a spores from environment to body will be high. Just like if some trauma or surgery has been done, that is contaminated with some contaminated dressing with mucosal spores, then there will be high chances. Same here. You can explain to you why, particularly at home, particularly patient with asymptomatic and mild, having is more number of mucormycosis, with underlying most common risk factor is diabetic, uncontrolled diabetic, or diabetic ketoacidosis, or you can say inadequate estrogen.
Thank you so much, Dr. Dr. Anil, can you just give us a key message for our audience? Dr. Anil, is there any key message which you want to give to our audience?
Yes, my key message, I would like to share my thought just I pen down after listening to all the speakers. First is the early suspicion should be considered always. Number one, whenever the clinician or the nursing staff or the patient is thinking that I might be suffered from mucor, you must suspect them, yes, mucor may be. Second, reversal of immune and metabolic abnormalities. Whatever the predisposing factor like diabetes or corticosteroid therapy or immunosuppressant, please try to either reduce the dose of these immunosuppressant or corticosteroid, or if feasible, better to stop all these immunosuppressant which may aggravate the occurrence of mucormycosis. Number two. Number three, institution of effective antifungal drug as early as possible, that has been told by Dr. Upinder and our other co-speaker. And third, surgical debridement, excision, cutting, and all the steps by which you can remove the mucor from our body, that may be our gastrointestinal tract, maybe our nasal cavity, maybe sinuses, maybe orbit, or maybe cerebral area. It's mandatory to remove it, cut it, excise it, wash it, and follow up for a longer time and plan for reconstitution. Reconstruction. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for giving this information to our audience. Thank you so much. Any other question which audience wants to ask?
Yes,
Any question from our speak from our experts? Thank you, all of you. So here we wind up this panel discussion with a vote of thanks. Honorable Organizing Chairperson, respected Principal Ma'am, Professor Dr. Lata Venkatesan, College of Nursing, our esteemed speakers, dear faculty members, ladies and gentlemen, and dear students, it is my proud privilege to propose a vote of thanks on behalf of College of Nursing on this significant day. I would like to place my hearty thanks to our organizing chairperson, Professor and Principal, College of Nursing, Dr. Lata Venkatesan, for her timely guidance, aptness, proactive attitude in taking up this event with so much zeal and fervor. I convey my gratitude to our eminent speakers, Dr. Gagandeep Singh, Associate Professor, Department of Microbiology, AIIMS, New Delhi, Dr. Upendra Betha, Assistant Professor, Department of Medicine, AIIMS, New Delhi, Dr. Sangeet Agarwal, Consultant, Department of Head and Neck Cancer Surgery, Sri Gangaram Hospital, Delhi, Dr. Purva Mathur, Professor and in Charge of Microbiology and Hospital Infection Control, JPNA Trauma Center, AIIMS, New Delhi, Dr. Anil Kumar, Additional Professor, Head Trauma and Emergency, AIIMS, Patna, and Ms. Sonia Chauhan, Senior Nursing Officer, AIIMS, New Delhi, for enlightening our audience with their immense knowledge regarding management of mucormycosis. Finally, I would like to take this opportunity to place on record my hearty thanks to all the faculty members of College of Nursing, AIIMS, New Delhi, for their enormous cooperation in organizing this event. I'm also grateful to the support of CMET staff, Set Facility staff, especially Mr. Susan Barrett, along with our clerical staff and supporting staff for their technical assistance and support. I must make a mention of Ms. Simran and Ms. Jyoti, our MSc second year students, for their continued technical support. I'm also thankful to the participants, and I must congratulate all of us for more than 300 views on YouTube. Thank you so much, one and all. Thank you.
So one more question which one of our delegate has asked, is there mucor release from the body if we excise that part? So Dr. Anil, can you answer this question? Dr. Anil, are you there with us? Okay, may I request Dr. Upendra to answer this question?
Pardon?
Is there mucor release from the body if we excise that part? Still, if it is there?
Yeah, basically what happens is you have to remove all parts where means this is a mucus hypothermia. If it's still persisting, then again there will be need of second means surgery. If you will not remove, then very difficult to treat with only antifungal agents. If you remove, then prognosis will be very good. And if you didn't remove all means properly, you have not done excision properly, and still there is some means fungal elements, then there will be chances of fungal treatment will be prolonged and survival will be poor. That's the main reason. That's the reason even after first debridement with antifungal treatment, again after imaging of 3 to 4 weeks, you have to see whether patient needs further debridement or surgical means intervention or not.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. Thank you,
Sophie. Yeah. I also personally thank all the panelists. I think more than the presentation, I think the interaction was well attended and well received. We were able to clarify all the doubts in the mind, including the myths and facts which is circulating in social media, which is really misguiding the public. You know, and I know you're all very busy. Even there is no time to prepare these slides. You know, that is the reality. So we are extremely thankful, and we acknowledge all your sincere service to the patients who are affected with COVID, and especially the complications like mucormycosis. And I also regret initially there were some technical glitches. There was echo and some disconnectivity was there. This was one of the most awaited session by everyone, because it's a new condition and everyone wants to know how to care for the patients. So we regret for the initial technical glitches which were caused. I think right from prevention, early recognition, and preparing for adverse events to that of proactive preparation. We have dealt the entire concept of mucormycosis and its management. So on behalf of College of Nursing, my sincere thanks to all the panelists and all the delegates. We have around 2,000 people who are watching the event in YouTube. And every time when we organize an event, we have 2,000 to 3,000 participants who are watching the event. That shows the confidence the entire nursing community is having on College of Nursing AIIMS and the Nursing Service Department of AIIMS. So I thank all the delegates and the faculty members who have made this event possible, especially Dr. Seema and Ms. Mamata. They have taken a lot of efforts in talking to the panelists, bringing them together and coining the questions, attending to the delegates' questions. It was wonderfully coordinated. Thank you all so much. Continue to support us in all the future events which we are organizing. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.